Physicists were both mystified and intrigued by Bohr's theory. They questioned why the energies of the hydrogen electron are quantized. Or, phrasing the question in a more concrete way, why is the electron in a Bohr atom restricted to orbiting the nucleus at certain fixed distances? For a decade, no one, not even Bohr himself, had a logical explanation. In 1924, Louis de Broglie provided a solution to the puzzle. De Broglie reasoned that if light waves can behave like a stream of particles, or photons, that perhaps particles such as electrons can possess wave properties. According to de Broglie, an electron bound to the nucleus behaves like a standing wave. Standing waves can be generated by plucking, say, a guitar string. The waves are described as standing or stationary because they do not travel along the string. Some points on the string called nodes do not move at all. That is, the amplitude of the wave at these points is zero. There is a node at each end, and there may be nodes between the ends. The greater the frequency of vibration, the shorter the wavelength of the standing wave, and the greater the number of nodes. What's interesting about standing waves is that there can only be certain wavelengths in any of the allowed motions of the string. De Broglie argued that if an electron behaves like a standing wave in the hydrogen atom, the length of the wave must fit the circumference of the orbit exactly. Otherwise, the wave would partially cancel itself on each successive orbit. Eventually, the amplitude of the wave would be reduced to zero, and the wave would not exist. In this figure, we see how the circumference of the orbit is equal to an integral number of wavelengths. This is an allowed orbit. Here, the circumference of the orbit is not equal to an integral number of wavelengths. As a result, the electron wave does not close in on itself. This is a non-allowed orbit. The relationship between the circumference of an allowed orbit, 2 pi r, and the wavelength, lambda, is given by this expression. Where r is the radius of the orbit, lambda is the wavelength of the electron wave, and n is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on. Because n is an integer, it follows that r can only have certain values as n increases from 1 to 2 to 3 and so on. And because the energy of the electron depends on the size of the orbit, or the value of r, its value must be quantized. De Broglie's reasoning led to the conclusion that waves can behave like particles, and particles can exhibit wave-like properties. De Broglie deduced that the particle and wave properties are related by the expression shown here. Where lambda, m, and u are the wavelengths in meters associated with the moving particle, its mass in kilograms, and its velocity in meters per second, respectively. This equation implies that a particle in motion can be treated as a wave, and a wave can exhibit the properties of a particle. Notice that the left side of the equation involves the wave-like property of wavelength, whereas the right side makes reference to mass, a distinct particle-like property. Question 7.5 asks us to calculate the wavelength of the particle in each of the following cases. The fastest serve in tennis is about 150 miles per hour, or 68 meters per second. Calculate the wavelength associated with the 0.060 kilogram tennis ball traveling at this speed. Well, to solve this problem, we're going to use the equation lambda is equal to Planck's constant divided by the mass multiplied by the speed. We'll plug in some numbers here. So lambda is going to be equal to 6.63 Planck's constant times 10 to the negative 34 joules times seconds divided by the mass in kilograms. And we're given 0.060 kilograms. And then we're going to multiply that by the speed in 68 meters per second. Keeping in mind that a joule is equal to a kilogram meter squared per second squared, we can see that units of kilograms cancel, seconds squared cancel, and meters squared cancel to leave us with meters for our wavelength. And when we put that into our calculator, we get that our lambda, our wavelength, is equal to 1.6 times 10 to the negative 34 meters. This is an exceedingly small wavelength, considering that the size of an atom itself is on the order of 1 times 10 to the negative 10 meters. For this reason, the wave properties of the tennis ball cannot be detected by any existing measuring device. In B, we're asked to calculate the wavelength associated with an electron with a mass of 9.1094 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms moving at the same speed. So we'll plug in our Planck's constant in our numerator, 6.63 times 10 to the negative 34 joules times seconds, divided by the mass, which is 9.1094 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms. And then we put in our speed, which is 68 meters per second. And we end up with a wavelength that is equal to 1.1 times 10 to the negative 5 meters. This wavelength is in the infrared region. This calculation shows that only electrons and other subatomic particles have measurable wavelengths. Shortly after de Broglie introduced his equation, Clinton Davison and Lester Germer in the United States and G.P. Thompson in England demonstrated that electrons do indeed possess wave-like properties. By directing a beam of electrons through a thin piece of gold foil, Thompson obtained a set of concentric rings on a screen, similar to the pattern observed when X-rays, which are waves, were used. In A, we see the diffraction pattern for X-rays that are passing through some aluminum foil. In electrons, which were originally thought to have only particle-like behavior, diffract exactly the same way as the X-rays do through the aluminum foil, demonstrating a similar pattern, which demonstrates that electrons can behave like X-rays and display wave properties.